Hello, everyone, and welcome to another session of the AWeber Virtual Office Hour. My name is Brandon Olson. I'm the Marketing Communications Manager at AWeber, and I'm joined by my teammate and buddy, Dave Stice. Dave, you want to say hello?
Introduce yourself. Hey, everybody. Yeah, how you doing? I'm Dave Stice. I'm the Product Manager for the email delivery team. Excited to be here today.
Awesome. Maybe tell them a little bit about what the email delivery team does.
Yeah, sure. So my team, it's pretty interesting. We are responsible for building the infrastructure and all the tools and back-end stuff that helps deliver your email to your subscribers on time, perfectly, efficiently, and in the hopes of getting all of your messages to the inbox. So yeah, there's a lot to build there. And then we're also focused on some more interesting user features such as conditional content. I'll show some of that stuff today. Some sort of new future technologies like AMP for email, which allow your emails to be interactive. We can talk a little bit about that later on also.
Cool. All right. Well, I'm excited to have Dave here. He's got some exciting new things to share with us today and some things he's already talked about in the past, but I think are really valuable. And we want to kind of revisit some of those things. I see Alexander and George joining us over on our Zoom call. And we're streaming too to Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, and Twitter. So if you're joining us on one of our other social channels, good to see you. Welcome. Be sure to introduce yourselves in the comments and say hello. Let us know where you're joining us from and maybe even how long you've been an AWeber customer, if you are an AWeber customer. But certainly welcome if you're not a customer of AWeber's. We're here to answer questions about AWeber as well as just generally email marketing best practices and tips. So. If this is your first time, and I know it's not for some of you like Alexander and George who are tuning in, if this is your first time, this is our twice weekly live stream where we are answering questions about email marketing, about AWeber, and other sort of marketing channels as well. So if you have any questions you'd like us to cover or answer today, or topics that you'd like us to talk about, just go ahead and put those into the chat, into the Q&A, or into the comments if you're on social media with us. I see Judy over on YouTube. Hey, Judy, good to see you. She's from New Hampshire.
Judy, I'm from New Hampshire as well.
Oh, really?
I grew up in New Hampshire. I wonder where she's from. I grew up in a little town called Hanover. Nice. Good to have a New Englander on.
And since this year, been a member. So she's been a customer for less than a year. Awesome. Well, we're glad to have you, Judy.
Yeah.
So she says Twin Mountain. Do you know where that is?
I don't exactly know where that is. I'll have to check it out. Sounds like a good place to hike though, for sure.
It does sound like a good place to hike. Awesome. Well, great. I'm glad to have you here, Judy. Glad to see Alexander and George as well. Let us know, Alexander, George, where you guys are tuning in from. We'd love to know. And if you've got a link to your website, go ahead and drop that into the comments too. We'd love to check out your site and all the awesome things you're doing with email marketing. So. All right, so let's go ahead and jump into the topic for today to kick things off, but certainly ask your questions and we will answer those as well. So let's go ahead. Dave, I'm gonna turn it over to you. I know Sure. you've got some really awesome new things to share with customers and with the viewers today.
Yeah, I think what I'd like to do today is show a couple of updates to some of the emails that we send as part of the platform, some emails you'll get from us as you are sending broadcasts. And as you gather new subscribers and grow your list, they have some neat little features in them, some tricks almost, but they're also things that you can use in your own emails pretty simply. I'd like to show you how to actually accomplish some of those, get your ideas flowing. And the good news is I'll show you how to do it. You don't have to memorize it because we'll have knowledge base articles up. Brandon will help me share some little snippets that you can cut and paste into your own emails. And then you can always reach out to us, talk to our customer solutions team. They're always here, not just for technical support, but to help you with your communications, with your business. So be sure to reach out. If you have a cool idea based on what you see today, let us know and I'll help you make that happen. All right. So yeah, let me go ahead and share my screen and show you some fun stuff here. Okay, we'll jump right into a little presentation. So actually the first thing I want to show you is an update to our broadcast quick stats notifications. And what that is, whenever you send out a, a new broadcast to say like 100 people or 1,000 people. A few hours later, you're going to get an email just confirming that your broadcast was sent. And it's going to give you some preliminary statistics of how your broadcast is performing so far. That just is a reminder of what email you sent, how many people you sent it to, and so far, how many folks have opened it up, how many have started clicking on links and stuff. So that's an email you're accustomed to getting already. And I can show you, basically we did a couple things to it. So we have a design update. It incorporates our updated brand marks and colors. Also just has a nicer, easier to read layout. Just kind of freshened up the design and give you some links to some additional resources. And the content at the bottom will be curating and just giving you relevant news along with this email. So be sure to check that out from time to time. So a couple of interesting things here. This is the name of the broadcast that went out. It shows me how many subscribers it went to and what list it was from. And also shows me my open rates and click rates in a nice bar chart. And actually, if you notice when I loaded it, those are animated bars. So it's kind of fun to see those load in as you open the email. You'll also notice there is a little lightning bolt icon up here. This means this is a dynamic and interactive email. It's an AMP for email message. So basically the cool thing here is the next time I come back tomorrow, the next day, or even just a few hours later, this email will change. It's going to show you changes to your open rates and click rates based on what's happening out there in the world. So your data in this email is actually always up to date. And that's something completely new, completely different that just wasn't possible before. So that we're excited to deliver that. This is our first email that we're sending to customers on a regular basis that has that superpower. And we have the infrastructure now to hopefully deliver more emails like this that are always up to date for you. So Brandon, that's a pretty cool thing. You can also come down here and hit the refresh button. You know, this broadcast for me is not going to update, but that's just a way for you to refresh the data if you want to take a look.
I think this is really, really cool. I mean, it really kind of shows you what you're capable of when it comes to email marketing. And, you know, Dave, you can talk some more about AMP, but what I really love about AMP for email, which is kind of a newer technology, is that it takes what was once a static medium, email, and makes it a dynamic, interactive experience for your subscribers where they, you know, potentially could do everything they need to do within the email and not have to leave and go somewhere else to do that. I'm sure Dave, you can talk, at length about all that too. So,
yeah, I think it's really neat. It does those two things that you spoke of. Just your email always has the up-to-date information. So, you know, a customer of yours can't call up and say like, hey, I saw there was a promotion for 50% off, but when I went to your website, it wouldn't let me do it. Well, maybe that promotion expired. So your email can reflect that change that expired, and maybe the 50% discount's gone, but you can still offer 10% off, or maybe you swapped it out for a newer promotion. So without having to send another email, that email will stay up to date for you. And then as Brandon was talking about, you can actually click inside these emails and take actions. So your subscribers could RSVP to an event, maybe write their name down on a pre-sale, lots of different things that they could do in there. So hopefully we'll be showing more examples of that. And enabling some of those cool features in our message editor. Right now it requires a little coding. It's a little bit advanced technically, but our aim is to bring more of these things to the message editor. Right now we do have a carousel object. So if you have, if you're in real estate and you're listing a property, instead of just showing one image of the house, you can actually have your subscribers swipe through and see multiple images. Same thing for a product on your Etsy shop or your Shopify shop. Yeah.
Can I show them really quickly kind of how we are using it in our newsletter? That might be kind of fun.
Yeah, that'd be great. Go for it.
All right, let me share my screen real quickly. So this is an email that we send every week. It's called our forward thinking email. And it's basically sort of our blog newsletter. So we highlight obviously like articles and other things that are in here, but we have As Dave mentioned, you see this little thunderbolt here. That means that this email is an AMP for email powered an AMP-powered email. And you'll notice that we have this sort of form in here, and it's actually a working form inside your email. So you don't actually have to click to go somewhere to fill out the form, but the form is actually living in here. So I could say something like, I love this newsletter. And then I'll hit submit, and you'll see that it says right down here, that's an interactive element. That was something we put in there to call it out so people knew. And then you hit submit, and there you go. It's basically submitted it right from the email. I don't actually have to go anywhere to submit anything. So that's one example of how we are using AMP for email in our own newsletter.
And I'll add to that, Brandon, You know, that's a very simple form. It just has one text area, right? But that could be a full-fledged form that you're used to having on your website. It could be a registration for a class or something. You could take pretty much all the information you need from your subscribers right off the bat without having them to, you know, go to your website and maybe get distracted by something else and forget to fill out the form. So it can be done there. So I just want to point out that you can have all sorts of fields, input fields, pretty much anything except for maybe sending a payment. I wouldn't try that right now.
Yeah. We've done some other stuff too in our newsletter, like having quick polls where they can pick one or the other. And it will show you the results right there in your email. You don't actually have to leave your email. So it kind of makes your email a web page in a way where you can interact with it and not ever have to leave your inbox to go check stuff out. So,
yeah. And I'll put something out there for you all who are listening today to get your feedback. I'd really be interested in maybe having a like button inside of an email. So your subscribers can see something, click a like button to basically represent that they're interested in that type of content. And they could even be tagged after liking something. So you can use that in future emails to segment your subscriber base. So let me know if you think a like button in an email or reactions like you see on Facebook and Instagram, if that would be something interesting for you to include in an email.
Yeah, I love it.
Great.
So I see Nathaniel is joining us over on Facebook. Hey, Nathaniel, good to see you. Vinny as well. Good to see you, Vinny. Alexander says he's from Hungary. All right. So you've got some other stuff. Any other use cases you want to cover when it comes to AMP
for email? For AMP, you know, there's almost limitless things that you can do with AMP for email. I think one application I'm interested in is e-commerce. You know, I put together a prototype. I think I showed it before of showing your Shopify store or an Etsy store inside of the email itself. So you can list some products for people to look at and try to drive them to your site. But with AMP, you could actually let them search your store, find products that they're interested in, you know, pinpoint one they want to find out more about and link directly to that product page. And, you know, with the aim of more likely getting them to make that purchase quickly.
Yeah.
So I think there's a lot of e-commerce applications.
Sweet.
All right. Let me find the present button here. Great. So we took a look at the broadcast quick stats email. Again, a nice design update. It also has the AMP for email dynamic elements. So I want to move on to conditional content. And what I'd like, actually, I have one more thing to show you before we do that. Let's go back to my email. I don't have it queued up. I want to show another conditional content email that we have going out around new subscribers. Actually, I'm just out of order. Here it is. Great. So another new email we're sending out. It's an update to new subscriber notifications. So you have a newsletter. You have maybe one of our AWeber landing pages, or you have a web form on your website. And when you are growing your list and receive a new subscriber, we email you about it to let you know, hey, your audience is growing. It's really awesome.
Hey, Dave.
Yeah.
Your volume went down quite a bit. Not sure if it's a
try.
There we go. Well, try that again.
Is that any better?
I'll try it again.
How about now?
There you go. Sounds a lot better.
Great. Yeah, for some reason, my headset comes in and out every once in a while, but plugging it back in seems to do the trick. I'll have to solve that soon. Anyway, in this email that we send out, you obviously can see your new subscriber, but a couple really interesting things are happening. Because this is an email we send out very often. You know, every single time you have a new subscriber, we're going to tell you about it. The email looks the same, except for the information about your new subscriber. So we decided to add in a little sentence in the beginning, which is meant to celebrate with you that your audience is growing. But instead of it just being a plain sentence, we've actually stacked about 50 or 60 different messages so that each time you get this email, we're going to randomly choose one of those and send it along with your email. And that happens automatically after you set it up. So that's really cool. If you have emails that kind of go out on a recurring basis and you want to, or if you want to make the experience a little bit different for each of your subscribers so they don't all have exactly the same messaging, you can set up the same thing. And I'll actually show you how to do that next. The other cool thing we're doing here is somehow we magically have a picture of your subscriber. And I think that's pretty neat. It's like, how did we get that, right? So this doesn't happen for every subscriber, but there's something called the Gravatar, which is basically for a lot of people who are on the internet, they upload their headshots. Maybe they're a blog author, or they comment on blogs and social media. Gravatar picks up on what your picture looks like, and it makes it available publicly, since it's already out there in the public. So we can actually grab that dynamically for each subscriber. You can do that in your emails as well, to show a picture of your subscriber and do something creative with it. So those are two updates to this email. And I think it would be great to go ahead and show you how some of this stuff is done. So I'll transition into the topic of conditional content. So topic number one will be, how can you shorten your emails with more targeted content, right? So I personally feel like maybe we write extra stuff in an email because we have a large audience. Some people are interested in topic A, some are interested in topic B, and we try to fit it all in there to please everyone. But what would be even better is if the email that I receive has information that I care about, topics that I'm interested in, and I don't have to, you know, filter through all the other information in that email. So this allows you to send one email to your entire audience, but it can be basically personalized and tailored to each subscriber's interests. So I'll give a simple example of what this can look like and how you can do it. So imagine I have an Etsy shop, and some of my audience are interested in, they're all interested in cross stitching, but some of them are interested in floral patterns. So here's a list of my products with that design style. Other of my subscribers, are interested in working on animal designs. So here's a block of content showing kits available in that style. And then for everybody else, I may not know what their preferences are yet. Maybe they haven't purchased anything. Maybe they haven't filled out a form on my website telling me their preferences. I can just give a more random array of products, or just show them what's new or what's popular. So that's kind of a catch-all. So that's pretty interesting. My email could look like this if I'm interested in flowers. It could look like that if I'm more interested in animals. And otherwise, it'll look like that. So there's something for everyone. Let me skip ahead. Sorry. So this is how you would go about doing that. What I'm showing you here is some conditional markup that you can write directly into the message editor, even the drag and drop editor. And if it looks like a math homework problem, don't worry. it does involve logic. It's got curly braces and percent signs. But once you work with it a little bit, it becomes pretty clear. And again, you don't need to memorize it or take notes. We have documentation, and we're happy to help you get started doing this. So basically, inside of my email, I'm going to start off with an if statement. And I'll just say, if the subscriber has tagged floral, then I want to show them floral designs. So that's where I would put the content of flowers. Else, if they're interested in animals, show them animal designs. Otherwise, just show them an assortment of popular products. And then there's a statement at the bottom to end it up, to just to close up that logic. So again, if floral, or if animals, else, everything else. And we can take a look at how that would look like in the message editor, maybe to make it a little bit more clear. So here's just a template I picked up. And it's basically an email sent from my Etsy shop is still the example. And you can see I basically dropped in one set of floral products, a set of animal products, and popular items as well. And for this example, I just created an image, but that could be any HTML content, anything you want to drag into that section. Above it, I dragged in a paragraph element just from right here. And I pasted in from my example this if statement, if floral in subscriber dot tags. So if that's true, they get this content. Else, if they like animals, they're going to get this content. Otherwise, they get this content, and then I end it. So when it comes down to it, it's pretty straightforward. Instead of your email containing all three of these sets of products, what gets sent out, it depends on who the subscriber is, and they'll just see one of those content blocks.
So Dave, what would happen if someone had both the animals and the floral tag? Would it show both of those or just the other?
Yeah, good question. So this is a pretty simple example. I wanted to be able to illustrate it as clearly as possible. So in this case, whatever matches first will win. So if they have floral and animals, in this case, they're going to get the floral products first. I could rewrite it so that they get both, or I can choose a winner between the two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. So that's how that's done. Again, you can kind of just design your email, and then when you're ready, drop in some paragraph elements to start typing in this markup here. So I know, you know, from experience working with people in AWeber and some customers, at first it looks a little daunting, but after you do it a couple times, it's pretty straightforward, and you can end up, using a template of what you've used before to make it easier next time. So there's a lot of information you have at hand. You know how your subscribers are tagged. You know their custom fields. Based on where they signed up, we kind of know their geographic location, their region. And also you're collecting custom fields on your forms and landing pages. So you may be able to discern other preferences like favorite animal equals cat or favorite animal is dog, etc. So you can really start to make use of that subscriber information that you're trying to collect. Brandon, any other questions about that example?
Gazelle over on our Facebook group is asking, so I'm able to set up a segment to sell products or other services on AWeber by segmenting my customers. And I'm not sure if that's a question related to what you're talking about, but we could probably talk about that right now.
I think in relation to what I'm showing, basically that's sort of right. Through tags and custom fields, you're basically calling out different segments of your audience and making sure they get the content that they will care most about, and you don't have to bother them with the other information or product listings.
Yeah, and I think one of the really neat things about this approach for those watching is that, instead of sending three different emails and creating three separate segments of people for, animals, floral, and everybody else, you're creating a single email and just putting the conditional logic in there to show the content that's relevant for the subscriber. And you can save yourself the time of having to go in to your subscriber management and create segments of those individuals and then scheduling out those messages individually. It's just one single email, one process, no needing to go create segments necessarily, because the email itself is actually doing the content segmentation, with the logic that you're putting into it.
That's right. Sort of rule of thumb for me is if you basically have the same email that's going to go to everybody, but you just want to fine tune it based on your subscriber preferences, that's a great time to use conditional content like this. If you're talking to two different groups of subscribers and you're sending them completely different content, in that case, it may just be a whole lot easier to send two emails. But this gives you an option to really just fine tune the messaging down to the subscriber level.
So it sounds like this is great for sort of e-commerce solutions or e-commerce businesses. Any other businesses that might find really a lot of value in this?
Yeah, I think anybody that publishes content on the web, if you're a designer, then you have a portfolio. If you have a blog, then you have different categories of content that you're writing about. And based on how your subscribers are interacting with your emails, with your websites, you can begin to learn which of your subscribers are interested in which content. So you can use tags for doing that. You can use some of our integration tools for basically cultivating information about subscribers and their preferences. So pretty much anybody that's sending to a large group of people, at some point, you're talking to a large crowd and everybody's different. And inside a large audience, you have a whole bunch of different subsets, sub audiences with different interests. So the more you can tailor your conversation to the individual, the better, the more likely they are to open your emails, interact with your content, come back to your website. So that's just something good to keep in mind as your list grows. Having a huge list is awesome, but then sometimes your messaging gets watered down. So this is an opportunity to really focus in there. And it's a time saver too. Like Brandon said, you don't need to send out, you know, 20 different messages because you have 20 different interest groups within your large audience. You might be able to do it within one email.
Yeah, I like that. We've talked in the past on our office hours about the importance of segmentation and sending targeted content, relevant content to your subscribers. That helps you build that trust and that relationship with your subscribers. They'll understand that you understand them, that you are sending them the most relevant content, related to what they are interested in or to where they're at in their journey with you. And that just strengthens that relationship because then they know that you understand who they are and they're not just an email address on your list, but they're an actual person. So that just strengthens that your ability to really build and strengthen that relationship with them.
Yeah. And that starts with the subject line too. You can personalize your subject line with conditional content. Also, you can address your subscribers by name and by their interest. And man, if I see my name and something I'm definitely interested in, I feel good about that email. I'm gonna check it out.
So that's interesting, Dave. You can use the conditional content you're talking about in the subject line as well?
You can. The subject line has a character limit, so it can't get too big, and some of this logic can break that limit. And we'll probably put in some changes to not count your conditional content against that limit. But yeah, you can totally do that. So I've done that a couple times and it can be pretty interesting. It's really nice to use randomization again to try out different subject lines. I know we have some A/B testing tools also, but it just keeps it from, you know, being the case where all of your subscribers get the same exact email, the same subject lines. It can really just feel a whole lot more personalized.
Awesome. I'm making notes and stuff I'm going to share with you later.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of people start off with their first subscriber, one person, right? They get to know that subscriber and you're probably having a very one-on-one conversation. Then when you get to 100 or 1,000 subscribers, things can become a lot more generic and your emails are like, hey, everybody.
If you're using conditional content and you're sending yourself a test message, can you bring through some of that and sit and kind of see how those different conditions are going to affect it?
You can, right now, you know, sending a send test, you can get some of that personalization in there.
You can show conditional, custom fields. I know you can you can send a test and insert those custom fields. I'm not sure about tags, but it's maybe something we can look at as well.
Yeah, so we have some capabilities there, but that's definitely, as more of our customers use conditional content, some previewing tools would really make their lives easier. Having us help check for, you know, syntax mistakes, typos, would probably be helpful. But yeah, there's a couple ways to test, and that would actually be a good KB article for me to write up is, all right, I'm writing conditional content. What are the gotchas and how do I make sure it goes smoothly? But number one, if you have any trouble, reach out to us right away and we'll get you over that stumbling block.
Yeah. And one way to kind of get around that or to test it out yourself is to just add yourself to your list and create sort of a segment for yourself that only contains you or variations of your email address. And then you can send out, you know, different, you can send out the message and have, you know, those different tags on different, you know, variations of your email address to see how it looks when it comes through.
That's a great point. I do that myself. It's super helpful. Great. So let's see what else we got here. All right. Show you some more tricks. All right. So you saw in the new subscriber notification that we somehow had the subscriber's headshot. And that can be kind of surprising to see. Because you obviously didn't send 1,000 personalized emails out, right? So how do we do the magic? So basically, Gravatar, you can go to, I think, gravatar.com, and it explains what the system is, how to work with it. You don't need to go too far into those details, but at the end of the day, I want to see a picture of somebody. And the way to get the picture of someone is to have their email address. And since you have a list of subscribers, you have a whole lot of email addresses. Some people don't have Gravatars. In that case, they get the generic Gravatar image. But there are, you know, some things you can control. If you don't like the default image, I don't personally like it, you can specify a different generic image. It could be a, you know, avatar shadow of a person, just showing that it's missing. In our case, we use sort of like a Rolodex icon, showing a contact card that somebody was added to your list. So that can be anything you want. You can also specify what size you want the image to be. We put a little CSS on it to round the corners and make it like a circle cropped image. That's fun. But actually fetching that image is pretty easy. So here's how we do it. Here I'm showing actual HTML markup for an image. That's what this image source thing is, right? But the important part is this URL. So these images live at gravatar.com/avatar and then some representation of the email address. So that kind of has to be encoded. So we have a little function called hash MD5. You don't need to know anything about that, but it just kind of converts the email address into an unrecognizable string, you know, so that it just protects your email address so it's not picked up and sniffed and stolen, right? So it helps with that a little bit. And this URL will actually render the Gravatar image for anybody who has one. And so here are some other options. Like I said, you can specify a size. So if I add a parameter to this URL, S equals 25, I'll get a 25 by 25 pixel headshot. And then here's how I specify a default image. I just say D equals, and then I link to some picture on the that's hosted on the internet. And so if I don't have Brandon's headshot, that picture is going to show up instead. And gravatar.com has a whole bunch of other options, but I think these are the most useful ones. So that's it.
So is it basically, you know, going and looking at the subscriber's email address and going to Gravatar and trying to find their Gravatar and pull that in? Is that how it's working?
Yeah, that's basically what it does. If there's an image there, great. If not, it'll show the default. So you don't really have to do any work. You don't have to really write any computer code. You just kind of have to specify things in this way. In fact, if you're working in the message editor, you don't need all this image source stuff, right? You just add an image and you can add a link to the image. You should be able to do something like this right in there, and it'll render the Gravatar.
Very cool.
So I think this makes sense as something to, you know, potentially add as a drag and drop element to message editor. So if people are interested in that, certainly let us know. Maybe we get that on the roadmap someday.
Sounds good. Yeah. All right. Teresa has a question related to, I think, what you were demoing before with conditional content. Can you use conditional content in affiliate marketing as well if you have different types of products from different sources?
Right. Yeah, absolutely. If you're using AWeber to send mail, you can use this in any case. So you could certainly do that. I guess the key would be to have an understanding of what different products or sources people are interested in. And you could certainly work that out.
Yeah. I mean, it's really whatever content you want to put in between those if else end statements, it's totally up to you. If you want to, you know, highlight you know, different products or services that you're an affiliate for, you can do that. If they're your own products, you can do that as well. It's totally up to you what content you put in between those different logics. And it can be images, it can be like copy, it can be HTML code as well. It's totally right. up to you what you want to do there. And the conditional logic is what's going to, you know, basically show the content, you know, pertaining to the subscriber's interests.
Yeah, that's right. I think that's a really good example. And if you'd like help getting started with that, Brandon will get your info and we can be in touch.
Sounds good. All right. So Dave, one of the things that I think a lot of our customers would find valuable when it comes to conditional content, I think some would obviously find value in kind of what you demonstrated here if they find a use case for that. But I think one that everybody could find a use for is what happens when they don't have a subscriber's first name. And instead of, and they want to use some personalization in their email, instead of it saying hi and then having a blank spot, what can they do? How can they use conditional content to make sure that, you know, they are able to kind of fill that blank state?
Right. That's a great question. So if you are using one of those personalization variables, and one of your subscribers doesn't have that information, as part of your AWeber account, we can do a fallback or have a default value to make the experience seamless. One of my pet peeves is getting an email that says, hello, space, comma, right? And obviously it meant to have my name there, but they didn't have my name, so they just left a blank space. Like, that's not an awesome experience at all. So why don't I jump in here and show you what that would look like. I'll just maybe I'll add a new slide. Cool. Okay, so if I want to say something like greetings subscriber dot first name, and we also have a little fun tool called human name. We should have a naming contest for this filter because it's kind of ridiculous. But what that means is I basically want it to be capitalized appropriately as if a human wrote it. I don't want to write Brandon Olson with a capital B and a lowercase O, and it just looks messy. So human name kind of cleans that up, gets capitalization right, makes sure it looks like it was written by a human.
Dave, your audio dropped out again.
All right.
Unplug it, plug it back in.
How about this? Is that, can you hear me all right?
Yeah, it's a little echoey, but it's all right.
All right. Let's talk like this, but I'll plug it back in and see how we go. Great. So can you hear me good?
Yep. That's fine.
Great. I think I'm back.
Yeah. Just
get out of the way. Okay. So have human name there. Great. You can use that if you want. I'll just keep this example simple. So I'm not showing too many things at the same time. So I have a first name, but what if somebody doesn't have the first name? I can simply write or friend. And the result will be either greetings, Brandon, or greetings, friend. So that way you never end up with the worst case scenario of greetings, comma, thanks for something. Yeah. This just looks pretty bad.
Yeah, and you can tell that it was, an auto-generated, greeting and I love the fallback. This is one of my favorite things about the conditional content is being able to have that fallback in the event that they don't have a first name.
Yeah, that's right. And you can use this in any case. There are ways to define your own set of data, or also to, if you're using custom fields, tags, et cetera, anything that you have. Maybe you don't know what city that subscriber's from. You can kind of fall back to use something else. So this or feature is available throughout, not just for first name.
That's great.
Yeah.
And it's not going to work for every single use case, but I think for the large majority of them, it will. Like, for example, if someone's, you know, first name, you know, if they put their in their first name, Dr., you know, Stephen, you know, Sorensen, for example, it's going to pull in Dr. As their first name. I think I'm right. You can tell me if I'm not right.
I would want to confirm. Yeah, I could try to confirm that for you.
There are some scenarios where it's not going to, it's not 100% that it's going to pull in the right type of personalization there. It all depends on what your subscribers put into that first name field.
That's right. I mean, there's a lot of different names out there, so it's hard to get every single one just right. If you find one that doesn't work, send it along to us and we'll try to solve it. So the next time you send it out, it looks better. For sure.
Sorry, your audio went out again.
All right.
Just go headphoneless.
This is going back to Amazon. It's going to get a lot of review. Great. So I have a couple more things I could show if you're interested.
Yeah, definitely. And while Dave's doing this, if you guys have any questions about anything else you want us to talk through or answer, just go ahead and put that into the comments and we'll cover that today. So we have about 17 or so more minutes. So
great. So one of the things I showed, you can see my screen, right, Brandon?
Not yet. Nope.
One of the things I showed early on is how you can make your email just a little bit more dynamic. So that you're not always sending the same message, or you want everybody's message to be slightly different. It can be a lot of fun just to have some different greetings or opening statements that you can randomly serve up. So in this case, I was just thinking about summer. Are you ready for summer? We'll have you ready for summer with these new options. Maybe it's a beach wear or something. Check out these summer fashions. Hit the beach in style. So you know, split testing, maybe you're doing one or two different variations of your emails. With this, you can try out a whole bunch of different opening statements. And you can do this wherever you like. So basically, I'm going to make a list of sentences like this that I want to shuffle through when the email is sent. Every subscriber will kind of get one of these at random. So let me show you how that, how that gets done. So those are the three sentences in this example, and you could really have as many as you want. And basically, I'm going to stick them into a list. So the curly braces are what you're used to seeing from conditional content. But I pretty much put a square bracket around them and commas in between them. That's how you set up a list. And then all you need to do to randomize is just go, actually just add here. Word random, and that's it.
So with the, vertical with the vertical line, right?
Yeah, that's a pipe. Oh, I didn't show up.
A there. Pipe.
Yeah.
Technical
pipe into the random. That's how we tell the left part of the statement to go into the right side, go into the random function.
Got it.
So it's pretty cool. So you can do random numbers. You can do a range of numbers between 1 and 1,000. Pick a random number. Maybe you want to do something with random numbers. You could show random, you know, blog content. You could do a whole lot of things with random. So, you know, the part where you have to make a list of all your sentences looks a bit clunky and messy, but it's really just sentences separated by commas. And then you choose a random one. So again, first time you do it, it might look a little funny. Once you send a preview, you'll see each subscriber just gets one of those and it looks nice and clean.
That's awesome. Very cool.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. So another place you can take this idea is with, you know, if you're a shop owner doing e-commerce stuff and you want to do promotions. I know some people say like scratch to win or, you know, scratch here to see your discount or your discounts waiting inside the email, see what you got. It just allows you to have a little bit of fun with promotions. So maybe I want to offer a 15, a 25 and 30% off promotion. But I want people to get different ones. You can do that targeted or you can do it random. So here's how to do it randomly. So this first statement says, set my promotion to 10, 20, 25, or 30%. And then again, I'm using that pipe into the random function. So promo is going to be assigned one of these values at random. And then when the email gets sent, it says you get 25% off in one example. So everybody's going to get something slightly different. So it's kind of a fun one.
I love that. So can you only do it with text that's in line, or would you be able to, like, you know, do different images that highlight different promotions?
Yeah, you could definitely do that. That's a lot of fun too. I wanted to show a really simple example, but that's what I was thinking as well. You could say, say something like, if promo equals 20, then you can say, like, in here you put an image. I'll just do like solar here for image for 20% off. And you can do that for the rest of them too. So that'd be else if promo equals 30%. Then you can just end it up with that end if. I'll bring this up in a second. There you go. So again, simple logic there. If the promo is 20%, show one image. If it's 30%, show the 30% image. You could also make the content dynamic if you get really fancy. So we can nerd out about that later another time to make this content block a lot smaller.
So Dave, a lot of the, so I'm not a coder. I'm sure our customers aren't, the majority of them probably don't know a whole lot of coding. Where can they find sort of a legend or directory, or you know the different coding language that you're talking about, so that they don't get confused about what to put in their conditional content?
Yeah, good question. So we have a lot of this information on our knowledge base. So after this, we can share direct links to those articles. What I'd like to do, instead of just sharing you the components, the parts, you know, the tools you have to use, I want to share more of these examples so that if you have a goal in mind, you can just follow that article, cut and paste, and drop in your content where it belongs and get off the ground really, really fast. So we have some knowledge-based articles now, and I hope to publish some more examples later.
Yeah, so let me just share my screen really quickly. Mm-hmm. And if you go to help.aweber.com and you just type in conditional content, you'll find a lot of the articles that Dave's been working on that he's going to continue to add to. And then there's an article here that says, what variables can I use? And I think this one goes into a lot of the different variables you can use with the conditional content. And then I believe the first one gives you sort of the different operators and logics that kind of go into it and what they all mean. So definitely go check that out. And sounds like, you know, Dave is going to be working on providing some more examples of ways that you can use it, which is great, because I think a lot of times it's hard to kind of take the technical piece of it and understand how you might apply it in your own particular scenario.
Yeah, and the best examples will really come from your questions. And don't worry about, is it conditional content? Is it something else? Just tell us, hey, I want to do this. What's the easiest, fastest, coolest way to do it? And we'll give you the best answer to solve that problem. And if it's a problem we think a lot of customers have, you know, we'll probably write an article about how you did what you did to show others how to do it.
Awesome. Cool. Let's see, Gazelle over on our Facebook group, she was asking if there's a way to set up an appointment with an AWeber team member to get some help. And I already replied to her, but I just want to make sure everyone else is aware that we don't have the ability to necessarily schedule an appointment with us because we're 24/7, and you can just call, reach out, live chat with us at any time of the day or night and get the help that you need. So no need to schedule an appointment. Just call in or live chat with us and get the help that you need. Our team will be there for as long or as little as you need us to be to answer questions and to help you get through the thing that you're working on. So don't hesitate to reach out if you need any support, any help with anything you're working on.
I just really love that, because I know if I'm working on a project and I get a little bit stuck and then I have to email a company for help, wait a day to get a response, and then wait another day to get scheduled, you know, a week goes by before I make any more progress. So being able to just call now, get an answer now, you know, keeps you running, keeps you moving, and, you know, gets your work out the door faster. It's great.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. All right. Anything else you want to cover, Dave?
That's all I have.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
That was a lot. And thank you so much for sharing all that.
No problem. So like I said in the beginning, if any of it looked like a math problem, don't worry. it'll start to look easier, and just ask us to help you with it.
Yeah, definitely. And lean upon those help articles that Dave is referring to.
Sure.
They have a lot of the language that you might use and the operators and explanation behind it all. And don't ever hesitate to reach out and get support from our team too when you're trying to do these things. So that's why we're there. And that's why what we want to do is we want to help you. So, all right, we have about 7 minutes left. So if anybody has any questions or anything you'd like us to kind of walk through, we can definitely use the last 7 minutes to do that. So go ahead and use the comments, put your questions in the comments or into the chat on Zoom. So Gazelle says, I think that's Gazelle. A little delayed on my end. There we go. Yes, Gazelle says, thank you, learned a bunch. Good to see, thanks for stopping by, Gazelle. So we got 7 minutes left, and if you've got any questions, you can definitely ask those here. I've got a bunch of topics we can cover if no questions come in. So definitely want to use the time to make the most of the time. So one question that came into our Facebook group the other day was how to, can't remember the exact scenario, but the solution was to bulk tag a subscriber in order to start them into a campaign. So if you've got existing subscribers that you want to put into a brand new campaign that you've put together, and for those who aren't familiar with what a campaign is, it is an automated series of emails that goes out to your subscribers on a frequency that you choose. And so let's say you've got subscribers on your list already and you want to get them into a new campaign that you've just created. The way that you would do that is you can manually put them in that campaign by bulk tagging them. So I want to show you how to do that. It's very simple and it only takes you just a few minutes to do. So let's jump into the dashboard real quickly. And underneath your,
What's really great about this idea is maybe you have information about your subscribers on another platform. Maybe it's your e-commerce shop, your blog, somewhere else where you've had interactions with your customer. You can import that information as a tag. And then all of a sudden, now you have a lot of great information about your subscribers that you can use conditional content for and really tailor your messages based on that information. So right now, if all you have is an email address, but if you can get more information from one of your other platforms, Brandon's going to show you how to get that in here now. You can start making use of it.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. So let's say I want to create a new campaign that's basically going to, deliver an automated sequence of emails for them. So I'm not going to go into too much depth with the campaign itself, but let's go ahead and create a new campaign from scratch. And we'll just call this a nurture campaign, for example. If I could spell, there we go. And then hit create. And then rather than it starting when someone subscribes brand new to my list, I'm going to have it start when a tag is applied. And I'll put in a new tag here. So let's call this nurture campaign. And then I'll just build my campaign. And I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this piece of it, because I want to show you how you go about bulk tagging your subscribers to get them into the campaign. But needless to say, you would just put all your messages in here. You can choose them that if you've already written them before, or you can create them from scratch right here. You have wait periods between them, those messages. And when you're ready, you just go ahead and save and exit. And then you would activate this campaign. And I can't activate it right now because I don't have any messages in it yet. So I'd have to go through and put those messages in. But once it's ready, I would click activate campaign. and it would turn into this green active button here. And then the next step is to go to your subscribers and identify which ones you want to put into this campaign. And you can kind of go down the list and check people's box, the boxes next to their names, or you can do a search. So let's say I wanted to look at people who were added. Sorry, added, where's my date added? There it is. I want to look at people who were added before maybe May 1st, for example. So anybody who is added to my list before May 1st would be in this sort of group of subscribers here. And while, when this loads, what I'm going to do here is rather than saving it as a segment, because you can't send a campaign to a saved segment, what you're going to do is you're going to check this box here, which is going to highlight all your subscribers on this first page. And you can see that I have a lot of pages here and over 30,000 subscribers here. So to select all of them, I'm just going to click this link here that says select all 30,003 subscribers. It's going to select all of them. And then under my actions dropdown, I'm going to go tag. And I would put in here the tag that I used when I created the campaign. And make sure I spell it right. There we go, nurture campaign. And then I would hit apply, and it would apply that tag to these subscribers, and they would begin receiving that campaign that I just created. So that's how you get existing subscribers into a brand new campaign.
Taking a long time manually. Do one by one, right?
Yes, it would. Yes, it would. Absolutely. What Dave talked about is in the import process, you can also tag subscribers and get them into a campaign as well. So there's lots of ways that you can tag a subscriber. what I showed you just now was how you would manually tag a subscriber from the subscriber management area. But when you actually import a new list of subscribers, you can tag them in that process. You can also use the import feature to add new tags to existing subscribers. And in the last 1 minute, I'll show you how to do that too. So the way you do that is in your add subscribers, you're going to import more than 10 multiple. That's new. They changed the verbiage there a little bit, which is fine. All right. Then you would either paste in the email addresses here, or you'd find the Excel spreadsheet or CSV file that you have for those subscribers, and you click on open. And then in this first section here, you're going to change this to add new and update existing. And from here, you can skip a lot of these things, except for email. Obviously, you need email, but you can skip pairing these fields together. So you're only basically matching the email address. And then what you're going to do is go to your next option, leave that where it is, go to your fourth step here, and then you would add a tag. And here you would put nurture campaign. And make sure that that campaign is active before you do this, otherwise they won't get into that campaign. So you activate your campaign, then you would import these, import and update subscribers here and add this tag at step number 4. And then you'd move on to step number 5, explain where you're getting these subscribers from. And in this case, all you have to do is say, I'm bulk tagging my subscribers, my existing subscribers. And our team will take a look at that import, and they will approve it and get it in there. So,
Brandon, if my import file had a column for tags, I could also use that to update the information.
Yes. Yeah, you could do that. So
that way, if every subscriber has a different set of tags.
So you'll notice down here that in my spreadsheet, it had a column for tags. I can match that up with the AWeber tags in here, the subscriber fields, and it will add additional tags to it, to that subscriber. If you match up other things like ad tracking or their name or custom fields, whatever you're importing is going to override what exists on that subscriber's profile. So just keep that in mind. Be aware of that. If you don't want to override anything with the import, then just deselect those or select the skip option. The only difference here is that with tags, it's not going to override the tags that you have. It will just add new tags to your subscriber. So that's how you would go about doing that. All right, we are out of time, but thank you guys so much for being with us today. Dave, thank you for sharing your knowledge and taking us through conditional content and AMP and all the awesome things. Cool. Well, we will, so today's Thursday. Our next session will be next Tuesday at 1 p.m. So be sure to join us then. Bring your questions with you. And if you want us to take a look at anything you're working on, definitely bring those with you as well and share those with us. And until then, we will see you on Tuesday.
Thanks, everybody.
All right. Have a good day.